Welcome to the show, and thanks so much for joining us. On 700 Club Interactive, we want you to help produce our show. All across the world, viewers like you have sent in questions on our different social media platforms, and these are topics you would like discussed.
That's right, and many of you had questions about worship. A viewer from YouTube asked, I've heard many different definitions of worship. Is it just the singing portion of church, or is it more?
Okay, so Ashley has the answer.
Please feel free to chime in. Worship is so much more than singing at church. Mm. Like, I believe as believers, we're called to worship God with everything inside of us, with our words, our thoughts, our actions, our devotion to Him. I love worship music, don't get me wrong. I feel like I listen to worship music a lot. And I have a 30-minute commute to work from work. Sometimes it's 40, so I'll be cranking that worship music on my way
Sometimes
in.
Sometimes it's 2 hours.
So, on a really bad day.
And the worship isn't
and
as great
I
on
need
that one.
The worship music to help me. But no, I mean, I think worship is so much, it's so much more. It's our entire dedication to the Lord.
The entire service is called a worship service.
Mm. Yeah.
So everything is. And when you look at it that way, start thinking of your entire life as an act of worship.
Yes.
You know, you get into Greek, because I always like to get into the Greek. It literally means to bow down.
Mm.
So you bow down and worship. And it's that bowing down, you acknowledge the sovereignty of God. So anything where you say, my Lord and my God, that when Thomas worshiped Jesus, doubting Thomas becomes he declares his divinity, my Lord and my God.
Mm-hmm.
It's that act of, I can't, but you can. And so it's not just the sacrifice of your lips. It's not just the praise. It's not just the singing. All of that is worship. But it's the tithing.
Mm-hmm.
That's an act of worship. That's a sacrifice. It's an act of worship.
Yeah.
Your obedience in life is an act of worship. Your love for one another, an act of worship. Your love to God, an act of worship. When you get into that mind frame, it can be transformative, because you're not just looking at an hour and a half on Sunday. You're looking at, well, the whole continuity of this, and not just continuity in your lifetime, but how are you forging a link to future lifetimes and future generations?
Yeah.
How are you influencing the people around you to break out into praise?
Mm.
Jesus said, if the crowd is not going to praise me, the very rocks are going to cry out. He is the creator. By him and through him, all things were made.
Mm-hmm.
And is due him our worship from just the fact that you have life and breath. So let everything that has breath praise the Lord.
Amen.
And it's in that praise that you get to communion. And in that communion and in that union with him, wonderful things happen, because you mm-hmm. start to reflect his glory.
Mm-hmm.
And there's just nothing else like it.
Amen.
I think I'm preaching. I got to stop.
Amen. I love it. Let's briefly talk about, like, the expression of worship.
Mm-hmm.
You know, you see a lot of people, I guess this could also be somewhat of a controversial topic, because some people don't feel comfortable raising their hands or going like this. There's actually a comedian that talks about the different hand motions. Like, down here, it's like you're holding a TV. You're holding a TV. And then up here is, you know, touchdown or something like that. But, you know, do you think expressing worship that way is a good thing?
It's a surrender.
Mm.
And from time immemorial, this has been surrender and worship. In the catacombs of Rome, you will find paintings of women leading the Eucharist.
Yeah.
The thanksgiving, and that's what that means,
mm-hmm.
the Eucharist of sharing the body and blood of Jesus,
mm.
and they are raising their hands.
Wow, that's beautiful. Do you raise your hands sometimes?
Yes.
Yeah?
Is
Me
that
too.
You?
Yes. Me too.
Have we been jumping in COVID around. Land so long that you haven't seen that? Yeah, I will actually get on my knees and bow my head to the carpet.
Yes, yes,
it's,
me too.
Yeah, yeah. These are things that it's in that expression where you another way to put it is how Paul put it, glory in your own weakness. Mm. In your own weakness, his strength is made perfect.
Amen.
And it's in that expression and that posture. Mm-hmm. My father taught me a long time ago, the only position that people will never want to take from you is when you're on your knees.
Wow.
And there's no greater sense of power than that. Mm. You have something that is unassailable, that will never be taken away from you. You know, Mary chose the good part to be on her knees at the feet of Jesus, hearing him and having fellowship with him. Jesus said very clearly, it will never be taken from her. Yeah. It will never be taken from you. That it's the perfect position for you to be in. And when you get that picture, let everything in your life be an act of worship.
Amen. I, in my own experience, being in the presence of God, your body can't help but also surrender, not just your mind and your heart, but I believe your body, because our bodies are a temple of the Holy Spirit, bows down and worships him too.
Yeah, and there's a great picture of this in the Garden of Gethsemane. Mm. Jesus is on his knees.
Wow.
On a stone beneath an olive tree, being pressed down. Mm. And he says, not my will, but your will be done.
Amen.
It's a great example for all Christians, all followers of Jesus, all disciples to take that same attitude, that not my will be done. God, I'm not asking you to bless my plan. I'm asking you to reveal your plan, what you want me to do. Mm-hmm. Not my will be done, but your will be done. And how can I do that and do that daily?
Amen. You're preaching, and
it's
okay.
I am, but that's okay.
All right, guys. Well, if you would like to ask us a question.
You're here to save me.
Yes, or give us a topic to talk about on the show. Make sure you visit our social media pages. Look for our posts on the different platforms, such as Facebook, Instagram, at 700 Club Interactive. You can also go to our YouTube page for extended interviews and stories and clips like this. Gordon?
Luis Medina could buy whatever he wanted, and what he wanted was luxury cars and lots of them. Ultimately, the spending caught up with him, and he couldn't keep up with the bills. Then Lewis was blindsided by something he never saw coming.
So it was when I was interviewing for a project. The owner of the business said, you're like a red Ferrari on the highway. You can write your own ticket. You can write your own pass.
Lewis Medina was a successful self-taught IT contractor. He made six figures and bought everything he, his wife Yvette, and two children wanted.
It felt really good knowing that I could go anywhere with the in the industry. And so I began to buy cars, BMWs, every model you can imagine back then I bought. My wife had Mercedes and Infiniti, and I got caught up in my job. At the same time, we were slowly drifting away from the church.
Spending got even more out of hand when the couple, on the advice of a bank representative, switched from using cash to credit cards.
And the gentleman, in order to build credit, you need to have a credit card, and then that we max that credit card out. Oh, we'll get another one.
Ultimately, the Medinas couldn't keep up with their monthly bills.
And I was always thinking, geez, why? He makes such good money. Why are we always, it seems like we never end up with anything.
We weren't good stewards of our money. It's like a sewer pipe if you're not careful. It starts to leak, but eventually it's just gonna bust. And then it's gonna seep into everything, maybe even my health.
Lewis was diagnosed with stage 4 liver cirrhosis. It shocked him since he worked out and didn't drink alcohol. Doctors said all of his organs would likely shut down and he'd die. The couple drained all of their savings and still ended up with over $84,000 of debt. It was a wake-up call for both Lewis and Yvette.
I said, I'm about to potentially face a holy God. And there was shame, you know? I felt like I hadn't lived up to who I should have been as a believer.
I had my moments where it was just like, God, I want my husband. I want to grow old with him. Lewis has always been the provider, but God gave me like a peace. It's like he reminded me, Lewis isn't your provider. I'm your provider.
So during this crisis, the couple stopped putting their confidence in paychecks and their possessions and chose to return to God, to church, and to tithing.
It brought us to a point where it was just, I surrender my pride. I surrender my money. It's not my money to begin with, it's yours. We just began to study his word and stand on his promises. And tithing was just, we just did that out of obedience.
The focus wasn't on how we were gonna make the money. It was just depending on God.
Man, we just began to see God's hand move.
Lewis underwent 35 surgeries in 15 months. The Medinas continued giving throughout that time, and Lewis eventually recovered from his sickness, allowing him to once again enjoy life with Yvette and their grown kids. Then, within a year and a half, they paid off their $84,000 debt.
I could finally put on that spreadsheet, paid in full for all of our accounts. We cut up the credit cards.
The hospital forgave a big portion of their medical bills, and Lewis started a family-owned IT business with his son. It's been doing well even during the coronavirus pandemic.
It feels so liberating. We have our priorities straight now. Number one is God.
Now, instead of buying things for themselves, they prefer to give to others through ministries like CBN.
We love donating to orphans and widows. You look at people differently. There's so much love. It's not about you. It's like, what can I do for somebody else?
Life does not consist of the abundance and the things that you possess. And that peace, I thought I could get with another 740 or a Mercedes. You just can't buy it. It's from God.
When you realize everything is from God, that he's given you everything, then tithing becomes very easy and becomes an act of worship where you say, Lord, all of these wonderful blessings have come from you, and I give back a tenth. It's my privilege to do that. And when you do that, you find one of the great secrets of the universe. We call it the law of reciprocity here at CBN. Give, and it shall be given unto you. Now, we didn't make it up. These are the words of Jesus. You can find it in the 6th chapter of the Gospel of Luke, so you can read it for yourself. It's in your Bible, too. Give, and it will be given unto you. And then he adds to it that it'll be heaped up, pressed down, running over. These amazing blessings can come to you. But when you forget God, and when you start thinking that it's your own power and ability or your own effort that has brought you these wonderful blessings, well, then you break that and you say, well, no, I'm not going to acknowledge God. I earned this, and so I'm going to keep it. And with that, you shut off the flow of blessing. God wants to bless his children. He wants to encourage them. He wants to provide all their need according to his riches and glory. What is he looking for? Well, he's looking for our obedience. Now, Lewis had to learn the hard way. Many of us have to learn the hard way. It's unfortunate in my life, many things I had to learn the hard way. But when you finally learn it and break through that blessing, well, then tithing becomes automatic. Yes, I'm going to do it God's way. It's not some get-rich-quick thing, and it's not some measure of holiness or anything like that. But you do walk into these incredible promises that he will open the windows of heaven, and he will pour out a blessing. Now, if you're not tithing, I encourage you to start and to do it right now. 1-800-700-7000. If you're giving, but it's still not adding up to 10%, again, I encourage you to tithe and to do it cheerfully, not from some mathematical equation, but when you do it cheerfully and generously, wonderful things can happen. The Bible says the measure you use, it will be measured back to you. So if you want to start, give us a call. 1-800-700-7000. Just say, I want to join the 700 Club. You can start at $20 a month. That's 65 cents a day. Some of you can join at higher levels. We have 700 Club Gold at $40 a month. $1,000 club, $1,000 a year, that breaks out to $84 a month. At whatever level, do it now. 1-800-700-7000. Now, when you join, I've got something for you. It's my father's latest book, The Power of the Holy Spirit in You, Understanding the Miraculous Power of God. It's yours when you call and join, so do it now. 1-800-700-7000. Known for their live comedy skits and viral videos, the Skit Guys and K-Love are joining together for their first feature-length film. Studio 5 gives us an exclusive look at their newest comedy, Family Camp.
Plus, Oscar winner Viola Davis pulls back the curtain on her acting career and more in her new memoir, Finding Me. Here's Ephraim Grimm with more in the latest in entertainment.
At number 5, are you born with destiny? Or does it just come knocking at your door?
He's a young singer from Memphis, Tennessee. Give him a warm hayride welcome. Mr. Elvis Presley.
It's a Studio 5 first look at Elvis, the latest biopic on the music legend, with the focus on his complex relationship with his manager, Colonel Tom Parker, played by Academy Award winner Tom Hanks, and in theaters in June.
We are the same, you and I. We are two odd, lonely children reaching for eternity.
At number 4.
And it's our official first look at Naomi Ackie as Whitney Houston. The poster just debuted for the upcoming biopic, I Want to Dance with Somebody. It's due out in theaters in December.
This was maybe the first time that I felt my anxiety around playing Whitney Houston was a little bit of a catalyst in a way that I hadn't previously experienced before. It was a very transformative time for me, but not necessarily because I was playing Whitney. It felt like a personal thing happening at the same time.
At number 3.
Every living soul God created, at birth, he gave all of you a gift. All of you in this room are gifted.
Words of inspiration from comedian Steve Harvey to his studio audience on Family Feud. In short, your gift is more important than your talent.
Your gift might be frying chicken. Some of y'all bake pies. Some of y'all do hair. Some of y'all fix cars. Some of y'all paint. Go do that. Go do that. Do your gift. Don't worry about which one of them talents. The reason you're struggling with that talent, because that ain't what you was built to do. You were built to do your gift. Discover your gift, change your life. That's the secret.
At number 2.
Family Camp is the highlight of our year. You ask our family, it's the greatest place on earth.
I'm sorry, I was late.
Again.
What do I gotta do to make it up to you?
How about we go to that camp?
It's a Studio 5 first look at Family Camp, the first feature-length film from the Skit Guys and K-Love Films. A fun family comedy in theaters in 2 short weeks.
I'm stuck here with Dr. Phil's demented twin brother when I should be back at the camp singing Kumbaya with my family.
It's okay, mi amigo. When God closes a door, he opens a Chick-fil-A.
At number 1.
They're back there right now calling me all kinds of names, calling me everything but a child of God. But they can't do nothing else because they ain't got what they wanted yet.
Oscar winner Viola Davis pulls back the curtain on her acting career, her childhood, and unimaginable poverty and abuse.
And then something happened within all of that. This little flicker, this little voice that said, I have the power to reject that. Mm. Mm. That is an opinion. That is not the truth.
It's all in her new memoir out this week titled Finding Me, where she reveals how she found peace, forgiveness, and a sense of self, and even how she prayed to find her husband.
I got on my knees, and I did. I said, I want a big black man from the South who's probably been married before, has kids, because I don't want any pressure in that department. Someone who's maybe been an actor who understands the artistic community. Someone who goes to church and loves God. I said, if you give me that, I'll start going to church, God. I really will. I'm committed to it. And then I signed off, just like writing a letter. And 3.5 weeks later, I met Julius from Texas, ex-football player, because I actually that's one of the things
you asked
I put
football
on the
player.
An football player, athlete. ex-football player, been married, raised his children on his own, was an actor, invited me to church. And I thought to myself, whoa.
Amen. I love that. All right, Ephraim. Amen. Yes, Lord.
I think Ashley just got encouraged.
I did. Jesus.
I see a
Thank
prayer
you.
Meeting happening soon.
3 weeks, Lord? Can it happen? Anyways, let's talk more about
the
Viola
Davis. Ticking.
Viola Davis just released her new memoir, Finding Me. Tell us more about it. I mean, I'm intrigued.
I'm in the middle of reading it now, and it really grabs your heart from the very beginning. One of the things she talks about, in addition to sharing the prayer that she did pray for her husband, and she meets him 3.5 weeks later, he does invite her to church. So naturally, she obeyed God, promised to God, and she's been in church with her husband ever since. But she talks about the whole issue of colorism and how she lived her life really thinking that she was ugly because of her darker skin, although she fought back. She was chased home by bullies every day of her elementary school life with bricks and things being thrown at her. Her dad was abusive to her mom. She talks about all the things that she endured, but literally still comes through and was able to forgive her father and had a great relationship with him, and actually still to this day has a wonderful relationship with her mom. Just to the power of faith and knowing that you are not your circumstances, you can rise above. That's what many people will take away from the book. Yeah. And like I said, I'm just getting started, but it's a great read.
Yeah, I mean, just her saying that, she says, I reject that. Mm-hmm. I have the power to reject that lie.
Yeah.
That's incredible.
Yeah,
Love
we
that.
Do. We got that power.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah. Don't let somebody else's opinion of you change what you think about you.
Amen.
And what God thinks about you.
Right.
That's the only opinion that matters.
What
God
thinks
God
about,
about you
is a fact.
Yes.
You got it.
Everything else
I like
is
that.
An opinion.
Mm-hmm. Amen.
All right, what can you tell us about the new film Family Camp from the Skit Guys and Caleb?
Well, I've seen some extensive clips from it. I'm actually going to spend some time with the cast next week in Nashville at their premiere. Looking forward to that. But it is a fun family film. It pits two families at a church family camp, and these two families are paired, and the families are polar opposites. So they don't get along. But in this experience, hopefully, there's some unity that happens. And as you can imagine, coming from the Skit Guys and K-Love, it is going to be filled with laughter, but also a message of hope and fun for us all to enjoy.
So how did you get this dream job where you get to go hang out in Nashville? Your thing?
You know, what? CBN has tapped me to do this. I have not complained one day.
That's awesome. I've definitely seen that guy in multiple skits that my church has played. Mm. He's really good. They're
yeah,
good.
Indeed.
All right. Well, what prompted Steve Harvey to share that inspirational word on Family Feud? It looks like they're kind of posting those clips to social media. Maybe?
Yeah, this was done a while ago, but many people don't realize Family Feud has a studio audience, and he does have conversations with the audience in between takes. You see them cleaning up. And there were some young people in the audience this go round, and he wanted them to know, prompted from a question, you know, how do I get where you are? To focus, so the answer to that question for him is focus on what God has gifted you to be able to do. Don't focus on money. Don't focus on trying to find the perfect job. Focus on finding what that gift is inside you. And he shares with that audience that one of the gifts his friends in Ohio knew very early on was that he liked to cut grass. And he goes, we'd be going out and he'd be just concentrated on cutting the grass of neighbors. Well, that guy actually made $4 million a year ago because he owns a lawn care business that cuts grass in the summer and actually removes snow in the winter. And he said that guy knew he loved it. He was gifted at it and he focused on it.
Yeah, that's good. Mm-hmm. I love it.
All right, we got time for Elvis.
Elvis.
I didn't know rock and roll started in a tent meeting. So.
It's something we're all going to learn, I guess. Indeed, the film Elvis stars Tom Hanks. It also stars a former Nickelodeon star, and we're going to learn about the 50s and 70s, Elvis's rise and fall. We'll see the connection to that revival. It's getting rave reviews. It'll be available in theaters in June, the end of June. Looking forward to seeing it.
I'm excited. Okay. I'm excited. Me too. My grandmother loved Elvis, so I like Elvis too.
Yes.
I'm excited. It looks good. It looks good. All right, Ephraim, thank you so much for being with us and for all of the latest in entertainment news. Check out Ephraim's weekly show, Studio 5. You can watch it on the CBN News channel or online at cbnnews.com/studio5. Thank you, Ephraim.
Are you lonesome tonight? We leave you these words from Hebrew. Let us hold fast the confession of our hope without wavering. For he who promised is faithful. Ashley's going to take that word and pray.
Amen. Rewe.
Hello, I'm Gordon Robertson. Thanks for watching the video. Be sure to like, subscribe, and hit the notification bell for more encouraging videos like this one. Welcome to the 700 Club Interactive Family, and God bless you.